My name is Jason Moore, and this is Jim Christ. We are going to give a tutorial today about multi-body dynamics and control, and but using Python tools to solve these kind of problems. We are both developers with the SymPy project, so this has a tight connection to SymPy, which is, show the website if you haven't found that. SymPy is a computer-aided algebra system that allows you to do symbolic mathematics. And we have a project that's sort of built on that, some SymPy foundations called PyDai, which allows you to simulate and do analyses for multi-body dynamic systems. And I'll talk about what those kind of systems are, too, in a few minutes. I'm currently at UC Davis. I'm a teaching professor there. And Jim is at Continuum Analytics recently, too. We both have degrees in mechanical engineering, and we work in biomechanics and robotics and control systems. So, and also in the back here is Alan Downey. He's also going to be a helper. So we'll...
helper?
Yeah, we're excited. And So between the three of us, two of us will be around in the room for answering questions, and I will, and then Jim and I will switch off teaching. So as far as answering questions, if you have ever done software carpentry, we're going to use their post-it note method, right? You're going to have two, you can pass them around. You're going to have two post-it notes. Yellow means I'm done with my exercise, I'm good, and you stick it on your laptop. Red means I need help, right? And you can post those up. And I might also have, when we ask questions, take some feedback through those. And then at the breaks, I'm going to have you guys give us some written feedback so that we can see how things are going. Since we got such a small group, how about we run around real quickly? You give your name and one sentence of why you love or like Python or why you're here. Okay? We'll start here. Snakes. Awesome.
My name is Kristen. I like Python because sometimes it feels like writing pseudocode that actually works.
Nice.
Nice.
Back. Okay, good.
I'm Lucas. I like Python because reflection is easier than any other language I've seen.
Natural. Great. Oh, the other one. SymPy, yeah.
Mark, I like it because it's very flexible.
Great. Open source.
I'm Richard. I like Python because it's not a large one.
I'm Amy. I like Python because of all the numerical things and scientific computing things you could do with it, because I'm a mathematician.
Awesome. Okay, you?
And I'm Carol. I love Python because you can do pretty much anything you want, and it's got a great community.
Great. Did we miss some people maybe that just came in? You?
My name's Cameron, and I like Python because C compilers make me cry.
In the back there, you maybe? What's your name and why you like Python?
I'm Elmo, because this is so much fun to write.
Cool. And I think you maybe is our last.
Don't know yet.
Don't know yet. Great. Then we get you. I think you're looking.
Yeah, I'm Rodolfo, and it's what thing is where I work. I just started working.
Awesome. Okay. Well, welcome, everybody. Nice to meet you all. So the next thing is a few questions. So how many people here have familiarity with sort of the SciPy stack? That's NumPy, SciPy, SymPy, et cetera. Who doesn't have a clue about what that is? Or not much? A couple, maybe? A little bit? Okay. Does anybody, we have like an intro notebook that sort of shows some things. Does anybody Are there enough people that feel like that we need that? Anybody would want to go over some of the intro things of any of those packages?
I think there's enough people to give it that
I can help.
Kind of like this.
Okay. That we should?
At least quickly. Yeah.
Okay, we can do that. I'll do that. And how many people have had like vector calculus? Raise your hand if you've, okay. Physics, like college level physics and stuff. Has anybody had dynamics or controls? Okay, great. All right, so good. That's fantastic. All right. Okay, so we've got about 9 IPython notebooks that we're going to go through. Raise your hand if you do not have all the software installed and have not successfully run the check in that underscore env.py. You haven't? So maybe Jim can help you out. So
I can help too.
You can help too. Maybe Alan could help you. Once you have this directory that you download and all the software installed, there's a check env.py. If you type Python,
hi, can you help me?
Check env.
Help me get things.
And if no errors pop up, you're good to go. Okay? So navigate in the terminal to this directory and then change into the notebooks directory. And you'll see that we have notebooks 1 through 9, or 0 through 9, Python indexing, of course. And go ahead and start the IPython notebook there. And it should pop up in your... We fixed a couple typos, but there's nothing functionally different. But you can update if you want to get pull if you cloned it, or just download the zip file again. That's fine, too. Okay? So we'll start with the notebook 0. If you click that.
I'm not sure we did it in pairs.
Hey, God. Could you guys be a little quiet? Thanks. So this is a little intro notebook. I'm going to go through it fast, since I think most people are comfortable with most, but just stop me if you have any questions about the specific things. So the first section is that we're going to, all this tutorial's in the IPython notebook. This is a sort of a web view, a web interface into using Python. And it's made up of cells. So if I select a cell and hit Shift Enter, right, I can execute cells, and I'm going to get output. And those first few bits show you some things about IPython. We're going to use particularly this load command, percent %load. We're going to have exercises, and we have all the solutions there. So if you're having trouble, you'll be able to percent %load in a solution. So that'll be how you'll bring in solutions in the exercises if you need them. Few other things there. You can just execute those and read them. I'm not going to go, there's the basics of Python, the different data structures. I'm going to skip that. Sounded like everybody at least has touched some into NumPy and IPython in the SciPy stack. So let's scroll down to the SciPy stack section. We're going to make use of IPython, NumPy, Matplotlib, SciPy, SymPy, and also the package we developed called PyDy. And you can start by importing some functions from NumPy, and NumPy allows you to work with arrays. And I guess I skipped an import up here. It looks like in the module section, import array. It should execute all the cells. Right, so we can work with array data. Is anybody, anybody not familiar with arrays in working with NumPy? Okay. Skip down to the matplotlib. So to get plots in the notebook, you execute percent matplot inline, and then we bring in some matplotlib functionality. And then you can plot arrays of data, and they'll show up in your notebook. So you can try those cells out. We're only going to use one function really from SciPy, and that's integrating ODEs. So SciPy has a number of ODE integrators, and there's a lot more out in the world. But this ODE int function gives access to a fortran routine written in the ODE APAC library called LSOTA. But Python has a nice interface, so you can define a function. That returns the derivative of y, in this case, dy, and it takes the vector y and the time t. And then you can provide an initial condition to that for that ODE, and then an array that you want to integrate across, in this case, from negative 5 to 5. Call ODE int and plot, and our function, if you take the derivative of just x, and you integrate that, right, you get a x squared curve. So we're going to make use of ODE int later. There's another more complicated one there that you can play with. Okay, and the main stuff that we're probably going to spend time in is SymPy. So SymPy lets you do symbolic algebra. If I import star here, bringing in all the functionality of SymPy, and now I can use this symbols function to create symbolic objects. So we see there that if I type a Python expression, it's actually going to render a nice mathematical expression for us. There's fun things like simplifying expressions. You can take the derivative of an expression with, in this case, with respect to time. I'm supposed to not point at the screen. You can do integrals in SymPy, definite integrals, etc. So SymPy is fundamentally a way to work with symbolic data types instead of numerics. Any questions on that intro notebook? That's like the fundamental basics packages that we're going to be using today. Anything? Make sense? Okay. All right, let's move on to notebook number one, Dynamics Introduction. So this is going to be mostly me giving a little intro to what multibody dynamics is and why it's interesting and sort of the basic concepts that we're going to use. So first of all, anytime you want to think about the motion of objects in the macro world, whether that's the motion of a person walking or a vehicle driving or us figuring out how a spacecraft goes around a planet, all these things are governed by Newton's laws. And the multibody dynamics we're going to teach is the study of all the motion of all these objects and how to apply Newton's laws so that we can predict the motion of these objects, and then maybe even control them too. And so these are some example systems that you might think, quadcopters, bicycles. I work in biomechanics, so we think a lot about how humans move and jump. But it fundamentally, everything boils down to F equals ma, right? This magic equation that Sir Isaac Newton came up with really governs all that. And it's deceptively simple looking, right? It says that the sum of all the forces on a system must equal its mass times acceleration. The sum of the forces have to be are fundamentally proportional to the accelerations of the system. And we're mostly interested in, though, the position of the object. So Newton's law starts with the acceleration. So the ODEs that I mentioned earlier, where they come in, is that we have to differentiate twice or integrate twice to the acceleration to get the position. So once we can form these fundamental relationships between the forces and accelerations, we can use that by integrating this equation to find the find the motion of these objects and make some predictions about that. So one key thing that the deceptively simple part is that we have to come up with those force and acceleration vectors, and they're not necessarily trivial. So to do that, we're going to make use of vectors, right? So vectors are objects that have magnitude and direction. And anytime you see an arrow, it's a vector, and also a curved arrow in one of the other directions, or an X and an O, is whether that vector points in or out of the screen. Since we only have a 2D plane to work with here, that's the representation. In vectors, I'm going to draw with an arrow over top. And unit vectors have a little hat on them. So a unit vector is a vector that has a magnitude of 1. And vectors then have a general magnitude. So to work with vectors, there's this nice module in SymPy, in the SymPy physics package called vectors, called Vector. And it allows us to do all of the computations that we need to do with vectors. For example, you can add vectors, as the diagram shows. So I'm going to import some stuff from SymPy. I bring in some symbols. And one oddity is that, and we'll talk about it a little later, is that all vectors in SymPy start with a reference frame. And I'll discuss the reference frames in a minute, but we start off with a reference frame, and a reference frame always has three unit vectors, in X, in Y, and in Z, in this case, associated with it. And so I can build up vectors just like I would write them by hand, right? So I have, in this case, the measure numbers, which are symbols, C, D, and E, that give me the magnitude of this three-dimensional vector. And these are all symbolic objects, and I can create different vectors with different symbols. And in this case, right, I can add them, and it does the right thing. So you add the measures of each of the vectors to get the sum. Okay, you can scale vectors, so all the expected things work. We have I can multiply a vector by 2. Here I can make the vector go in the opposite direction. We also have all the classic three-dimensional dot products and cross products. So the dot product is useful to find out the angle between two vectors. It also helps you can determine the magnitude of a vector, right? If you want the scalar magnitude of the vector, you can use dot products. We're going to use projections because we're going to be working with multiple reference frames that we define vectors in. And then also, you can find out if vectors are perpendicular, for example, and also computing power. If you have two vectors, one that describes force and velocity, you can get the power of the system. So we have dot product in SymPy, and that gives you a scalar value, right? It's the Euclidean norm. That's the dot product. And then we also have the cross product. Cross products are going to be very useful because we, in particular, all torques that we're going to deal with, right? They're a lever arm, some vector that describes a lever arm crossed with the force that acts on that lever arm. And that's going to give us the torques. So they're going to be helpful. So we can do cross products, and it'll compute that. You get a vector, and that vector is always perpendicular to the plane that the two vectors that you're finding the cross product are in. So there's lots of mathematical properties about vectors and dot products and cross products, and you can take a look at those. But the nice thing is that SymPy is going to enforce all these rules and let us use those. Okay, so the thing about multi-body dynamics is it's much easier to try to map out where points are and map out vectors and such when you make use of multiple reference frames. And that's where a lot of the complication comes in. What do you think what points are we interested in these kind of systems? Any idea? Center of mass, yeah. So all rigid bodies, we're going to work with rigid bodies. The key is if we can find the acceleration of the center of mass. We don't have to find the acceleration at every point, but there's, you know, the fundamentals are we can find the center of mass. So we're going to be mapping out locations of the center masses of bodies, and we're going to use vectors to map those positions, right? So in this case, we see two reference frames listed. One that's designated with the unit vectors AX, AY, and AZ, and another one, B, which is rotated with respect to A, that's represented by these B unit vectors. And if we want the position from the toe to the hand, in this case, which would be described by the vector R, we could get there in two ways, right? I could go along the B vectors, the B unit vectors, distance FX and FY, or I can go along the A vector, the A unit vectors, DX, DY, to get there. And the nice thing that we have here in SymPy is that if you define the relationships between the two reference frames, we can use as many vectors as we want in different reference frames to combine and get to the points that we want. So if you scroll down a little bit, I have a little code here that implements that. So in this case, I create one reference frame, and then I create a second reference frame, B. And this says that I'm going to rotate about a single axis. That axis is A dot Z, the vector pointing out of the board, through an angle theta. Right? So that defines the relationship between A and B here. I rotate through an angle theta relative to the A frame. And then I define the vectors A and B into two different reference frames. So A has some coordinates in the A frame, and then this B has coordinates in the B frame. And just to see what they look like, all right, so I have these two frames that are expressed in different reference frames with different unit vectors. But all our operations still work correctly, right? I can still add those vectors. And you see it's a mixture of the unit vectors there. I can do dot products and cross products, right? All that stuff is sort of magically happening behind the scene. And then another useful thing is, A plus B is a mixture of two reference frames. Well, maybe I want it all expressed in one reference frame. So the express method will ensure that I get the that same vector all expressed in the one reference frame with all A unit vectors, right? And then the DCM method stands for direction cosine matrices, which I'll speak more over too, but that can return to you the rotation matrix that defines the relationship from those two. So I'm gonna go to the board and just go over this concept. Any questions so far about what I'm talking about there? No? Does everybody understand that enough? Do I need to? I'm gonna go over this though, because it's usually confusing. So I usually teach this with a box. So if I have a cube here, all the sides just have a length L, for example. And imagine that this box has a lid. And we're going to open that lid. And I'm not doing a great job drawing. Okay, we're going to open that lid, and we're going to open that lid through an angle theta. Right, and the goal that I'm going to do is I want to make a vector from this point, I'll call it P, to this point O, and we're going to make use of two reference frames to do that. Okay, so the first reference frame is got the directions. I'm going to put X down and Z is going to go in this direction. And then we have to follow the right-hand rule. So X into Y has to be in the direction Z. So Y is going to be out here. Right? So this is reference frame one that's made up by X, Y, and Z. Okay? Now, I want to attach a new reference frame to the lid, right? If I open up this lid, the Y is now pointing here, so we'll call that Y prime, right? And the X is pointing like this, and that's also through an angle theta. Okay? And then finally, the Z-axis, which is the same axis that we're rotating about, this back of the lid, it's the same, right? So we didn't change Z, we rotated about Z. So we have these two reference frames. We got the XYZ one and the XYZ prime one. And we want to get the vector R. Draw that with blue. To there, right? Vector R. And the nice thing about using multiple reference frames is that I can write the vector by using components, and I can go along these reference frames. So I'm going to follow. I'm going to go, you know, one vector here, one vector here, one vector here, and one vector here to get to that point. So I'll take those four components, and to get to that point. So starting at P, and I'll write this R of O with respect to P equals some the combination of vectors. So the first point is from P to this point is length L, right, in the negative x direction. And I'll use a hat here to make sure that we call it a unit vector. And then the next one, what's the next one? Anybody? Minus L in Y hat. All right, Y hat. And then how about the next one? Any idea? Plus L Y hat prime. And then the final one. You know it, right?
Yeah, well, plus L, Z hat.
Plus L, Z hat. Right? So that's the kind of vector that I'm showing on screen in the computer. We basically can use these unit vectors, traverse along using these reference frames to get to the points we want. Does that make sense to everybody? Any questions? And the other thing to note here is that that expression, when I call dot express, right, I can change all these y prime hats into y hats. I mean, into just y and z or x and y. And to do that, you have to have the rotation matrices defined. Right, so the rotation matrix that I show on the screen comes from. So say I want to express, I'm going to look my eye right down this direction. Right, and what I would see is an X and a Y, and then an X prime and a Y prime rotated through this angle theta. And all we're going to work on is 2D rotations today with our example problem. But you can then write, for example, if I want to transform what the Y primes are, and in this case, Z and prime and Z prime equal, but so all we have one Y prime in here that we need to express. So Y prime, does anybody know what that equals in terms of X and Y? Anybody want to give a shot?
Using that equation for R?
No, I just want to know what the unit vector Y hat is, but in terms of the unit vectors X hat, I'm probably blocking you, sorry. X hat and Y hat.
Hats are orthonormal, right?
All the hats are orthonormal.
Okay.
Yep.
Then it's
And I'll start over here. I'm hearing something there. What was that?
Y prime cosine theta.
So I'll write like this. Cosine theta, y prime.
So are all the angles direct to each of the bases?
Are all of the angles direct to each of the bases? I'm not sure I understand that question.
Well, we've got some, my eyes are going a bit, but we've got some angles going to all of the, so we've got some angles in there.
I'll draw it again.
Is there like an angle corresponding to each of the bases which goes to the bases?
Yep, it's just one angle theta, and I'll draw it here better so you can see.
Oh, we're in 2D. I thought we were in 3D.
Never mind. It's a mix. So all of this stuff is all in 3D. We're going to do a 2D problem today, and this is my eyeball. I was just going to look down that view because we're only rotating the lid in one angle, about one axis, so we can think about it in 2D and draw this picture in 2D to think about the relationship. But we're going to end up. I'll end up with a 3D rotation matrix. Okay.
Plus sine theta prime, right?
Yeah. Is it a plus or a minus? So there's definitely going to be sine theta. And I'm not sure if it's right either. So the way to do that is if you want to know the components, right? So the y component, right, is the cosine theta, and that's a unit. So that's a plus in plus direction, but the x prime is in the negative, right? And that's the... negative sign, right? Is that right? Everybody agree with that?
Wait a minute. We're doing y prime in terms of
that. I missed my prime up here. I apologize. So that's why you guys are probably backwards. I wanted to get y prime in terms of x. Does that make sense now? So I'm trying to find y prime in terms of x and y. X and y. All right, so then in that case, we have a minus sine theta x plus cosine theta y.
Isn't an x and y hats?
Hats. Yeah. Okay. Agree with that? So then you can plug that in here, and we would eventually, we'd have a vector expressed only in that first reference frame. So that's the concept there. And then you can build up the rotation matrix, right? You can also write the z hat prime is easy, right? That just equals z because we just have a 2D rotation. And then the x hat prime in this case has two positive components from both the x and the y. And then you switch, so it's cosine theta x, sine theta y. Okay, and then you can write that in matrix form. So x hat is the cosine theta. It's the first entry here. And then sine theta. And zero. There's no component in z. Y hat is negative sine theta. Cosine theta. Zero. No. And then this is 0, 0, 1. Right? This is the rotation matrix that I show. Right? This 3x3. Make sense? Any questions? So what this software lets us do is write out vectors in whatever reference frame we want, and it's going to resolve all those computations to to get us back to expressing vectors in one reference frame. And that's basically, it's a fundamental tool to let us write out vectors in a simple way so we can get it in our head space and then and not be too complicated. Okay? Yeah, you all, in this module is based around the concept of reference frame. So if you had a vector that you only wanted to work in one reference frame, you just have to create the base one.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, then you always want to, whereas if you're just doing some general vector algebra where you're just saying, you know, A cross B dot C, and then, you know, something like, let's say, the triple product identity,
yeah.
Then you don't really need a reference frame. You can just kind of do it.
Yeah, that's correct. It's just we'll call it. Can I just put a symbol for a vector instead of a built up of components?
Yeah.
We don't have that functionality in there. We have you can do that with maybe matrix symbols in SymPy, right?
The new vector. Doesn't the new vector module?
We don't. I don't know if we have a.
I think there's symbolic vectors.
Yeah, I don't think we have, there's some other vector types in SymPy that we could look at and investigate, but in general, this is the way, this one's built for solving these kind of problems, and that's sort of and you always have more than one reference frame in general. Okay? So reference frames are attached to rigid bodies, and rigid bodies are really only a reference frame and a point that represents the center of mass. We're going to build up positional vectors. And then to form Newton's laws, we have to get acceleration. So we're going to have to take derivatives of vectors. And there's a lot of built-in support for doing that easily. So in this case, we had an A vector. And if I want to take the derivative of this vector A with respect to C, but notice there's one more argument. You got to give it the reference frame you want the vector in. So when you're dealing with multiple reference frames, you always have to tell it what reference frame you want to take that derivative in. So if I take it in A versus N, right, we get a different, maybe I haven't defined that above. I'm going to define, well, that's a live demo failing, but anyways, all derivatives are taken with respect to reference frames. And a lot of this stuff is going to happen behind the scenes, too. We're going to deal with angular velocities, right, so this linkage, right, rotates through the angles Q1 and Q2 with a rotation pointing out of the board. And A omega B and B omega C says this is the angular velocity of this body C, for example, with respect to the body B. So we can define also all of our velocities relative to the different reference frames that we create. And those are also represented by vectors. There's some useful relationships. So, for example, if you have two points and both of those exist on the same reference frame, so they're fixed in distance, and you rotate, and that body's rotating through space, this formula holds, right? It says that the velocity of the point defined by the vector P in the reference frame A equals the velocity of that point P in the reference frame B of the body that's rotating, plus the angular velocity of the body in the reference frame A crossed with the vector between the two points. So these are just some fundamental relationships that you'd have to write out by hand normally, but we have methods. For example, that one holds with the V2 point theory method. And we're going to make use of that too. So we'll explain that more when we get to that in the example. So basically, there's all these complicated derivative rules, right, when you have multiple reference frames, and this software tracks that stuff. Okay. We're going to deal with inertial properties of objects too, right? So every rigid body has a mass, but it also has an inertia. And that inertia is defined by a tensor of 9 values. It's a symmetric matrix, a 3x3 matrix. The diagonals represent the principal components of inertia of an object. So that's wrong, what I just said. The diagonals are the moments of inertia, and then the off diagonals are the products of inertia. And so all nine of those numbers give you an idea of how the mass is distributed in space of a particular object. And we're going to define all these inertia tensors with respect to typically the reference frame so if you have a rigid body and a reference frame is attached to that rigid body, we're going to define the inertia with respect to that. And the little N there in the corner represents that we have to remember that all of our inertia tensors have to be referenced to a reference frame. And we actually represent these inertial quantities just like we represent vectors. Instead of a unit vector, we have a unit tensor that's attached to a reference frame. And you can build up with the nine quantities a dyadic, is what this is called, to hold all the information. And it has the reference frame you've defined the inertia with respect to and all nine of those values. And this is an example of what that looks like. So you can easily create an inertia providing the nine values. You need a reference frame again. And that's what an inertia dyadic looks like with all nine values. And then if you want to see its matrix form, you can say, let me see that inertia with respect to the reference frame in. And there's the familiar inertia tensor that you've probably seen. Okay. Forces, moments, and torques, right? So forces are really just vectors that are acting at a point. And in SymPy and all the code you see, we're going to use those. We're just going to really represent them as a tuple and a point object. So we have a point class that allows you to specify points, and you can give them positions and velocities. And then a force is really just going to be marrying the point and the vector. Torques always act between reference frames or bodies, and so you're going to have to. You always have to define what reference frames that the torque is acting between. So the torque, and that is analogous to the force. You have to have a reference frame and a torque vector. Okay. So with all those pieces, we're going to be able to come up with vectors for the forces and the positions. And we're going to differentiate them twice to get the accelerations. And we're going to come up with Newton's second law, the linear law. And then there's also the equivalence rotational law, which is Euler's equation. The sum of all the torques equals the inertia. And this is sort of simplified for this case. But the sum of all the torques equals the inertia times the angular accelerations of the bodies. And once you get a hold of those, they fundamentally define you can put them in first order form. They're an ordinary differential equation in time. And our goal is to get a hold of this ordinary differential equation so then we can simulate, integrate this equation and see how the body moves, how this object that we've defined moves. Okay. So that's like the quick overview of multiple body dynamics. Does anybody have any questions there? I'm not expecting you to know or learn all that, but I think as we work through the problem, you'll see where all these pieces. And I'm sorry to blab so long too. We'll have more exercises and all the other notebooks. But that's sort of a 10-minute intro to graduate level dynamics to some degree. So, anybody questions? This one's fixed to three, and we have some other facilities in SymPy that you can do higher order things and stuff. We have differential geometry we can do tensors.
There's also geometric algebra.
Which I think is fundamental, like Clifford algebras and stuff, and you can make things as high dimensional as you want and have all these concepts. But all this stuff only applies to three. Like, and if you know, like a cross product doesn't mean anything beyond anything with three dimensions. Yeah.
So is there any support for doing stuff like Lagrange formulas or Hamilton formulas?
For
dynamic on the dynamic side.
For this stuff? Absolutely, yeah. So we have we're not going to see it today, but we have, for example, we have a method called Lagrange's method, and you basically form the Lagrange and pass it in, and it crunches the numbers and spits out X dot for you.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Okay. All right, so I'm going to let Jim take it over. He's going to...
you're covering the intro.
Oh, I'm covering the intro?
Yeah, you're covering the intro.
Okay. Yeah. Sorry. Okay, so open up notebook number 2. And this is just a quick intro of like what the problem we're going to do. So I work in biomechanics, and I work on trying to understand how people walk and balance. And one of the first things, though, you have to try to figure out is, well, how do people just balance when they're standing still? So we're going to work with an example problem that is based on human motion and standing. It's just going to be a 2D planar problem, right? And we're going to have 3 joints. We're going to have essentially a joint at your ankle, your knee, and your hip. And we're going to model how we stand up, right? And we're going to try to make the model stand up with a controller in the very last notebook. But first, we got to get a hold of that model. So there's a few things. It's 2D motion, 3 degrees of freedom. Like I said, the 2 legs move together. They're like glued together, right? So we're not thinking of 2 legs and 2 arms. And we're going to assume that all the forces that we generate from our muscles, we're going to just lump them into torques acting at the joints. So there'll be a torque at your knee that controls how your knee moves, right? And if you run the commands, you'll see a diagram here. So this is essentially a free-to-body diagram that we'll reference during the tutorial, right? We're going to have the 3 bodies here, T, U, L, and then the inertial body, which is your foot's glued to the floor, I, ankle joint, knee joint, and hip joint. And then each of these bodies here, right, they have inertia, a mass, and an inertia. And we have only one number, it's in 2D, and we're going to assume that the bodies are symmetric, so to keep it simple. And then that mass has a location, a distance dl, du, and dt between the joints, right, the mass center. So this is, and we're going to work with multiple reference frames. We'll have the inertial reference frame, I, and then as we work up the body, like we have the L reference frame there, the U reference frame, and the T reference frame. And those are all going to be rotated with respect to each other by these 3 angles, theta 1, 2, and 3, right? And so the first, the lower leg is rotated with respect to the ankle through theta 1. The upper leg with respect to the lower leg through theta 2. So we're going to build this up as a serial chain of bodies. And finally, these torques vectors represent the 3 torques that are going to operate between the bodies. Okay? And there's some explanation there if you want to read, but I think and there's also gravity, right? Gravity's going to be pointing in the negative y direction. Okay, any questions on the problem description? All right, now I'll let Tim take it over.
So in this part, we're going to be doing the first step. I should probably have this with me, shouldn't I? The first step of actually deriving the equations that model the system that Jason just described. And so we're developing the kinematics here. And so what we need to do for that is to specify all of the locations, so what all the reference frames are in our system, and all of the points in that system, where all the masses are, where the joints are, and then relating the quantities like velocity to those things. So I'm going to start working on the board. Hang on. Uh, While I'm erasing this, does everyone have their notebook open? Is the, like iPython notebook? Is that all set up? Everyone's got all the software installed. You're all good to go.
Notebook 3.
Yep. If you don't, we have two people around the room that can help.
Can someone help me?
Okay.
Sorry. I didn't have any time.
All right. Everyone else is good, though? Awesome. Awesome. All right. So the first thing you need to do is, you know, import all the things we need. So from SymPy, we're going to be importing symbols, which create symbols to represent the different quantities.
Okay.
And then physics mechanics is where most of the functionality we're going to be using is today. So run that import. A couple more initialization things. Jason, how do you scroll on your computer? Oh, I figured it out. All right, and then we're also using the image functionality for IPython. So the first thing we need to do is create those reference frames. So if you remember, our system is a person. So we have a terrible foot. We got our foot right here. Leg, next part of the leg. So those are all blobs, just generic bodies in space. So each of those has, I need this. All right, so we're creating our system. So these are foot, lower leg, upper leg, and torso. And each of those blobs has an axis. I'm going to redraw that real quick. And so they all get their own reference frame. And so we're going to be creating first the different reference frames to represent our system. So it's pretty easy to do that. You pass a letter representing what you're going to call that reference frame here. So here we're creating the inertial reference frame. This represents ground. It's what the person's standing on. Their feet are attached to it. And then we'll also create a reference frame to represent the lower leg. So to just give you guys some practice using this library, we're going to ask you to create two more reference frames, one upper leg frame and also a torso frame named U and T. If you get stuck, you can put your red post-it note out, and then when you're done, if you can put your yellow post-it note on your computer. So that lets us know how people are going through the exercises. If you didn't get post-it notes, or we have more up here too. So the solution is in the next cell down. You can see the parentheses sign, load, and then the name of the file. So that'll also, if you run that cell, it'll pull up the solution that we've created for you.
Oh, I see. And if you've done a evaluate notebook, then it just pulls the solution in for you.
Yeah. Yeah. Looks like most people have that figured out. So I'm going to load up. You need help?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'm going to keep going because we're running a little behind schedule. So I'm going to load up the solution here. So similar as above, we just pass in a letter to represent the frame and then create a reference frame for it. So these are just reference frames right now. They have no relation to each other. We haven't said how they're oriented. We haven't done any of that yet. So I'm going to draw those up here. I don't remember how we oriented our guy. I think he was facing the other way. So we have our axes. So that's one reference frame. Give another one at this joint. And
So we need to say how those are all related to each other. These are overlapping. There's one more here I missed. And so to do that, we need something called generalized coordinates. So if we have our global system right here, here's our inertial frame. Give it a, you know, get an X and a Y and then a Z coming out. Those would be like, if you're plotting ever, you have Cartesian coordinates, that's what you call those. That's our inertial frame, that's our inertial coordinates. Generalized coordinates are more like values, how you would relate one to the other. And so in this case, the easiest way to say how these relate is just by their angles between them. So in SymPy, it's easy enough. You just create three different symbols. So we have theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3. And that's going to express the angles between our reference frames. So I can run that. So now we have to start actually orienting our frames to each other. So here is the relation between the ankle, which is rotating the lower leg, and then the inertial frame. And so that's rotated by theta 1. So that relates our inertial frame right here and our lower leg frame, rotated by an angle theta 1. So the command for doing that, the end goal of this whole notebook is to have expressed what our system looks like. So building this whole thing in space. So we are going to orient our lower leg frame with respect to our inertial frame. It's an axis rotation, so we're rotating about an axis. And then here we have a tuple of the angle we're rotating about, and then the vector we're rotating about. Or not the, so the angle, the actual value of the rotation, and then the vector expressing what the rotation is about. So in this case, it's about z in the inertial frame, and it's a rotation of theta 1. So I can run that. And so now, lower leg frame is expressed in relation to the inertial frame. And so now we can create the direction cosine matrix that Jason was talking about earlier and see that, you know, yes, we have the cosines and sines that we would actually expect representing that rotation. So it can go the other way too. So we can express the relation between the inertial frame and the lower leg frame both ways. So now we need to orient the next joint or the next segment up, which is the upper leg, in relation to the lower leg. So I got another image right here. Oh, scrolling. All right, so that's rotated about theta 2. So the relation between that is the same as we had before. We had theta 1 orienting the lower leg to the foot, so the inertial frame. And now we're going to rotate the upper leg in relation to the lower leg by theta 2. So that angle is theta 2. So it's the same as before. We have the upper leg is oriented with respect to the lower leg frame. It's an axis rotation, a value of theta 2, and it's about the z-axis of the lower leg frame. So it's not the inertial frame. We're rotating about the z-axis of the lower leg frame. So just run that again. So now we've expressed the lower leg in relation to inertial, and we've expressed the upper leg in relation to the lower leg. So you can guess that the next thing we're going to end up doing, I guess we're showing the DCM matrices. So you can see doing this by hand would get complicated fast for a long chain. It's already a moderate expression. The next one's going to be bigger, and so if we had five links or whatever, it would be, you know, very large. So SymPy has already helped us with that. This can be simplified a little bit, though. So simplify is the command. So we'll simplify that matrix, and yeah, that's cleaned up nice. So the next one is an exercise for you to do. We need to orient our last reference frame, so the one expressing the torso. So same as before, when you're done, if you can do the yellow post-it note on your computer, and a red one if you're having trouble. So it's very similar to the ones we did above. Let's load that image up. So here is the torso and the upper leg. rotating about theta 3 about the z-axis of the upper leg. So if we load up a previous solution, as you can see before, orienting in the torso frame with respect to the upper leg frame, it's an axis rotation of value theta 3, and then about the upper leg frame z-axis. And then we'll right away plot out the direction cosine matrix relating the torso frame and the inertial frame, and simplify that right away too. Okay, so far what we've done is we have expressed the four reference frames. So I've drawn these at different origins, so they all have different points as they align with the axes, but this package doesn't actually have different location reference frames. They're just rotations right now. So if I was to redraw these, they're all on top of each other. So here's our inertial, one for the lower leg, one for the upper leg, one for the torso. So we need to start expressing points in space representing the joints. And so that's going to be translations along axes. So I'm going to redraw this leg or whole figure. It's a stick figure to help with clarity. So here's our foot, lower leg with a joint there, got a joint at the ankle. So this is our knee. That's our hip. And he is bending way over to make this really clear. And so that's our torso. And here's reference frame one. Two, three, and four. So we need to start expressing where these joints are in space as points. So creating a point, it's much like creating a reference frame. You give it a name, and that's it. So here's point A. That's going to represent our ankle. And then we need to give a length for the lower leg, so how long it is. And we're going to express that symbolically, so we can change it later. We could use an actual number, but this is nice, so we can try out different models later on. So we create a symbolic length. We also create a point for the knee. So right now, as with the reference before, this is just floating in space. We have some point A and we have some point K, and they're not related to anything at all. So we are going to set the relation between the knee position and the ankle, so point K and point A. And again, it's much like orienting the reference frames before. So knee, set position, with relation to the ankle, and then we give it a vector. And so this is a constant, this is symbolic, just a value, and then we have a vector here saying what axis it's along. So here is, we have an X axis, we have a y-axis, and our length is, what did we call that? L underscore L. Yeah. So from ankle, point A, to K, it's a distance of L underscore L along the y-axis of the lower leg reference frame. So that's what we've expressed here. Length L along the y-axis of the lower leg reference frame from the ankle to the knee. So now our system knows where the knee is in relation to the ankle. So we can keep going up that, and we're going to end up expressing where all those points are. So, we can also determine what that distance is. So that's the position from, as we said before, L underscore L along the y-axis. We can also express that in a different reference frame. So that is in the lower leg one. We can express it in the inertial frame. So position from express, as Jason showed before in the intro, in the inertial frame, and then we're going to simplify it because it might be complicated. Are there any questions? so far? Excellent. Okay, keeping going. So we're going to keep going up the chain. So we're going to create a symbolic length for the upper leg. We're going to give it a point for the hip. We are going to then set the position as before. The distance from the knee to the hip is the length of the upper leg along the upper leg frame y-axis. And then we'll show that that actually worked by getting the position. And so we can also express that in the inertial frame. Okay, so we have now created point A for the ankle, point K for the knee, and point H for the hip. And the length of that is LU. So we have a couple more points we need to express. These are where the joints are. The other thing we care about is where all the center of masses are. And so that's going to help us express our dynamics later. And so that's one of an exercise open for you. We have 3 points along here. We have the center of mass for the lower leg, center of mass for the upper leg, and the center of mass for the torso. And so in the notebook, we tell you what to name them, and you need to create those points and then orient them in space, much as we did the knees before. And again, remember the post-it notes so we can help people out. So you can load the solution before using this cell, the load exercise solution. So we created some symbols to express the lengths. So symbols can take a string separated by commas of different values, or you can pass them one at a time. So we created D underscore L to represent the length of the lower leg, or from the ankle to the center of mass of the lower leg. D underscore U to represent the knee to, always going to forget that, to the center of mass of the upper leg. And D underscore T from the hip to the center of mass of the torso. And then we created points, L-naught, U-naught, and T-naught to represent the center of masses, and we positioned them. So walking up the chain, lower leg mass center is from the ankle, the length of the lower leg, so D underscore L, or lower leg to the center of mass along the y-axis of the lower leg frame. And then the rest progress from there. Are there any questions on that? It was a mildly complicated exercise. So just want to make sure everyone's up to speed. Cool, excellent. All right, we'll move on. So far, we have expressed where all the reference frames are, where all of our points are in space. So we only have a couple more things we need to do. And one is to get the kinematical differential equations. So if you remember, we talked about generalized speed or generalized coordinates. Originally, we had our theta 1 expressing the ankle of the lower leg, theta 2 of the upper leg, and theta 3 of the torso. So those are our positions. So now we need to get our generalized speeds. And so that is going to be the expression omega naught. So this is the angular velocity about these joints. We have the angular position. So the angular velocity, omega n, or omega 1, omega 2, or omega, and omega 3. And so for this problem, this is very simple. It's just omega 1 is equal to theta 1, the derivative. So omega 1, omega 2, and omega 3 are our generalized speeds. And the kinematical differential equations we expect to sum to 0. And so we can just say since omega n, so omega 1 equals theta 1 dot, omega 2 equals theta 2 dot, so on and so forth, we can just set that difference here. So theta 1 dot diff is the derivative of theta.
So dynamic symbols just means that they have time derivatives?
Yes. So in SymPy, that's creating a function and then taking that of t. And so it's a function of time. I should have explained that earlier. Apologies. Now we need to express the angular velocities. So for an exercise, we need to set the angular velocity of each frame. So to do that, you, is this an exercise? Yeah, so we can set the lower leg frame. So lower leg frame, the angular velocity, reference to the inertial frame is just omega 1, inertial frame z. So remember the z comes out of the board, so it's the angular velocity is about z. So that's the magnitude of our angular velocity, and so we can set it like that. So we're saying what is the speed of that frame as it's moving. And so then we can also determine what the angular velocity in the inertial frame is. And it's just omega 1 about the z-axis. So if you could do that for the next two reference frames going up, so one for the upper leg and one for the torso. So we are setting the velocity or the angular velocity of the lower leg frame with respect to the inertial frame. It's just omega 1 about the inertial frame z, lower leg frame, omega 2 about the inertial frame z, and the upper leg frame, omega 3 about the inertial frame z. All right. So the last thing we have to do is set the inertial or the linear velocities of all of our points. So we've expressed how the frames are rotating. We need to now express how the points are translating. So the ankle is easy. The ankle's not moving. The person's standing still. So we're setting the velocity of the ankle in the inertial frame, so in ground, as zero. He's not moving at all. And then we're going to be using the V2 point theory function, which expresses this relation here. So that's saying that the velocity of point 2 is equal to the velocity of point 1, both in the inertial frame, plus the angular velocity of frame A, which they're both in, cross product with the distance between them. So in this one, we're saying the lower leg, center of mass, we're saying that the point 1 is the ankle, the inertial frame is I, and the lower leg frame is A. And so we're just going to be walking through that for all of them. So in this case, the lower leg frame is A. In this case, the upper leg frame is A. And then we're repeating it for the knee and the hip. So at this point, what we have done is we have expressed the entire chain of... I think it's working right now.
So if you've got those things where you say things like, just the previous section, lower leg frame, go up to set angle. Well, no, do it on for the torso. Torso frame, set angle, velocity, upper leg frame, omega 3 times, inertial frame goes in. Why isn't it upper leg rather than inertial frame?
I think it could be upper leg, because they're aligned in this case.
I tried it, because that's how I did it first, and I got the same.
Yeah, it should be the same. They're aligned. All right, while he's handling that, I'm just going to quick recap, and then we're going to take a break. So at this point, we have expressed how our reference frames are oriented with respect to each other. We have said where all of our points are in space. We've said how fast the reference frames are moving, so their angular velocity. And we have said how fast the points are moving, so their linear velocity. So now our system is fully described in space. So after we come back from the break, we're going to start assigning masses and forces to what's going on. So a quick 5-minute break, grab some water. There might be snacks, I don't know. And then meet back here. We'll say, 2:33?
And also take feedback from all the notes. So on each of your sticky notes, write a positive and a negative so far from what you've learned or what we should do better, what we're doing too slow, or what is good, and pass them as you come out, and we'll adjust accordingly.
So now let's move on to notebook 4.
this notebook as a, now that we have all the kinematics defined, right, so we know we've basically defined the positions and velocity information for all of the bodies, all their mass centers, and all of the angular velocities between the reference frames. So now we're going to create, now we're going to tell the software that these reference frames are actually rigid bodies. And to do that, we're going to add information. And that information is we need to know a mass of each of the bodies, and we need to know the inertia of each of the bodies, how the mass is distributed around around its, with respect to its reference frames. So even if you had the not working solutions, we'll import there from solution kinematics. That brings us in the correct solutions from the last notebook. We're going to bring in inertia and rigid body. Inertia is a function from simplified physics mechanics, and rigid body is a new class that's going to allow us to create rigid body objects. And then we'll bring in a couple of SymPy things. We'll turn back the nice printing. And the masses are quite simple, right? All we need to do is define a symbol, ML, MU, and MT, for each of the bodies, each of the three bodies. The inertia, we're going to make use of the inertia function. So if you remember in the introduction to the problem, I said that we're going to assume that the bodies are symmetric, right? So all we're going to have is a single inertia term out of that tensor about the z-axis, the one that's pointing out of the screen, and we're going to define how the mass is distributed with respect to the mass center of that body with respect to the z-axis. And we'll assume that the our legs looking from the side aren't perfectly symmetric, but it's an okay assumption to make here just to keep things simple. So we're going to need three symbols for the inertia, the moments of inertia, and we have one for each of the three bodies. And then the inertia function, it takes the reference frame that you define the inertia in as the first argument, and then the next three to six arguments will fill up that inertia tensor. So in our case, the first three are the x, y, are the moments of inertia with respect to the x, y, and z axes of that reference frame. And we're going to set the x and y to zero because we're not worried about rotations in the x and y direction, only about the z. And then we'll set the z to the value, the symbol that we have above. So what that generates is this dyadic that I talked about in the introduction, right? And this is it's essentially a tensor that has the reference frame information attached to it. So it says that we have a inertia scalar value here, ILZ, that is about the ZZ, the Z axis, right? And so you can also have cross terms in inertia, so you could see like IZ in this case, IZ crossed IY, or vice versa. You could get up to nine terms. But we're only going to have one, keep it very simple. And we can take a look at that inertia matrix too, right? So that inertia matrix or tensor only has a value in the Z component, right? And then the last thing that we do to set the inertia is we simply make a tuple that pairs the inertia dyadic with a point, right? So the inertia dyadic describes the inertia with respect to the reference frame, and then we say we're going to associate it with that point. So we're defining, you can define the inertia with respect to many points on the body, and it changes as you look at the inertia from a different point, reference to a different point. So in this, we're going to create a tuple that says our inertia that we're defined is going to match up with being respect to the mass center of that lower leg. Right? So that is the gist of defining inertia for one of the bodies, in this case, the lower leg. And then the upper leg is the same thing, those two cells. And then for you guys, for the last one, go ahead and you know, exercise typing the same thing and make the inertia dyadic, and then the inertia tuple, which we would call the central inertia for the torso, and put up your yellow stickies when you're done. If you need help, put up the red sticky. And if you didn't get a new sticky, does everybody have stickies? Do I need to pass them around? So we got good feedback. A few of you, you know, said that you didn't have a strong enough background, and I don't know if we can solve that right now. But feel free to ask lots of questions. If you want any clarification, we're happy to answer questions about that. And then also some thought we were going too fast or too slow, so it was a mix of on the exercises, whether we were given enough time. So we'll give a little more, make sure we give a little more time this time for the exercises so we can get everybody a chance to finish. And thanks for all the other good feedback, especially the ones we can improve the in the future, improve some of the slides and things. And we'll probably collect some more at the end from you too, so be thinking. Now we have our inertia is defined, a tuple of the inertia and the point that's with respect to. That's the solution, same as above, just with the different variable names. Now we can create rigid body objects. All right, so we have a class here that generates a rigid body object, and a rigid body gets a name. That's the first argument. It gets a mass center, a point object. It gets a reference frame as the third object, and then it gets its mass and inertia. So those, excluding the name, those four elements are sort of would encompass a rigid body. So I've created the rigid body there, and before I'll just add a new cell, and we can see that the lower leg rigid body, if I do dot tab, right, I have some methods that are useful. So rigid bodies come with a lot of things. I can compute its angular momentum, find its central inertia that we gave it, its kinetic energy, potential energy, linear momentum, various different methods and attributes there that are useful. And the next in the next notebook, the classes that we use to sort of finally generate the equations of motion are going to be pulling a lot of that information behind the scenes to build up the equations of motion. But the rigid body encompasses everything that you would expect from a rigid body definition in a dynamical sense. So for the last exercise, go ahead and create those last two rigid bodies and reset your stickies, and let me know if you need a Facebook sticky. All this can handle very complex inertia definitions, though, too, if you need it in 3D and with respect to any points you want, and et cetera. But for this problem, that's all we've got, all we're going to do. Okay, so Jim's up next, and he's going to talk about applying the kinetics, all the forces and torques that we need to think about.
So we have our system defined in space. We now have the masses defined, so the only other thing we're missing is the forces. So as with all of them, we're going to start with some imports, set up SymPy's pruning, and import IPython's image functionality. Cool. So we have a couple forces acting on our system. I'm always going to forget to grab this. We have gravity. So big G pointing down. Gravity is affecting all of the centers of mass. And then we also have the torques that we talked about earlier. I'll draw those in black too. So each joint is, we're lumping all of the muscle torques that your leg or hip or knee would provide into one, and we're applying a torque about that joint. So we need to specify both the torques and the effect of gravity on the system. So we create a symbolic gravity, so a symbol G to express gravity. And then forces are vectors. So the lower leg gravity force vector. So the force of gravity on the lower leg is going to be force of gravity going down there is negative. So because it's going down, it's not going up in the inertial frame. Lower leg mass times g, the acceleration of gravity, times the inertial frame dot y. So what we've created is a force vector going down, not up, because the inertial frame dot y goes up. So it's negative, so it's going down. And then F equals ma, if you remember from your physics course. So we have the acceleration of gravity, which is the a, and then we have the mass of the lower leg center of mass. So that's the force that is affecting the leg there. We store forces as tuples because they have a location. So we need to know where is that force actually acting at, and then we need to know what is the value of that force. So we have a tuple with the first element as the lower leg mass center. So that is, where is it actually affecting? And then the force vector. So what is the force that's being enacted upon it? So as I said, yeah, it's a... So the type of the first one's a point, it's the location, and the type of the second is a vector, because forces are vectors. So we need to do that again for the upper leg and the torso. So I'll just run this cell real quick. So that creates the same. They're almost identical expressions. The mass of the that object times g times the inertial frame, and that's all negative because it's pointing down. So the second set of mass or forces that are actually affecting our system are the joint torques. So torques are expressed as vectors about an axis. Oh, I'm getting a little ahead of myself here. We need to create some new dynamic symbols. These express the torques. The torques can change with time, so they are functions of time. So they're dynamic symbols, not normal symbols. Symbols are for constants like gravity. So we create three dynamic symbols, ankle torque, knee torque, and hip torque. We'll call them TA, or T underscore A, T underscore K, and T underscore H, T for torque. So here is what the lower leg looks like. So the lower leg has two torques acting on it. If you remember Newton's third law, every option action equal and opposite reaction. So because the lower leg is enacting a torque about the knee on the upper leg, the upper leg is enacting a torque on the lower leg. So that's why we have this TK going clockwise, not counterclockwise. And so you have to sum all the torques. And so our total torque on our lower leg is TA plus the torque up here, which is minus TK. So it's TA minus TK. So our lower leg torque vector is equal to the ankle torque. So that's TA. It's a value about the inertial frame Z. So torques are expressed as vectors. And the direction of the vector is the vector that it's rotating about. Who here does or who here knows what torque means? What I mean by that when I say it. For those that don't, you can think of torques as like when you have a wrench and you're tightening a nut. Torque is the rotational force. So forces have a direction you're pushing. If I was to be, you know, pushing my car up a hill, the force would be in the direction that I'm pushing it. Torques, the direction is what you're rotating about. And the convention is counterclockwise. So if I have a force or a torque, if I'm rotating counterclockwise, it goes up. We're creating lower leg torque, ankle torque about the inertial frame Z, minus knee torque also about the inertial frame Z. The reason we're using inertial frame is just for simplicity. All the Z-axis are aligned. This Z-axis, and the Z-axis all point out. I think that was your question earlier. So created that vector, and we can display it. Just TA minus TK, all about inertial frame Z. We're going to repeat again, creating a tuple, the lower leg torque. So we have the frame that it's expressed in, and then the torque vector. So the difference between forces and torques, at least in this system, we express forces as a tuple with a point and a vector. Torques are a reference frame and a vector because the torque doesn't necessarily enact at a point. It's rotating a frame. So we need to repeat that again for the upper leg. So I can run that cell. It's almost identical. And one for the torso. The torso doesn't have a corresponding negative torque. Nothing's enacting at the top of it. So that's just TH. So the hip torque about inertial frame Z, and it's enacting the torso frame. All right, and so that is kinetics. We have created the forces on our system. Our system is all set up, and we're ready to derive the equations of motion. So that is the next notebook. I don't think I'm going to draw that. Before I go on, are there any questions? Excellent, excellent. So the equations of motion, what I mean by that is the equations that express what our system is doing. This is how you can actually simulate the system. We can get pretty plots or animations or whatever about how our guy is acting in time. So we're going to be using Kane's method, which may be unfamiliar for a lot of people. I had not used it until grad school. It's complicated, mildly. But we have a nice fancy class in SymPy called the Kane's method class that does all of the actual manipulations for you. So really, it's just passing in the system that we've already described. So as always, do some imports. We're going to be importing trigsimp, which does simplification of trigonometric functions. That's one of the SymPy's functions. And then Kane's method from SymPy Physics Mechanics, which is the class that does all of the actual mathy stuff. Set up printing. We can actually look at what Kane's method needs. So it takes in an inertial frame. Q-ind, those are the generalized coordinates. Those are independent. You don't need to worry about that for this problem. We don't have constraints like that. And U-ind, which is the generalized velocities. So stepping back real quick, generalized coordinates. Generalized coordinates are theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3. And for the velocities, we have omega 1, omega 2, and omega 3. So those are the symbols that express what our system is doing in space. So after that, we also take in constraints, which we don't have. And that's it. That's it. So that's all we're going to pass in. So we get our coordinate vector, theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3. It's a list. We get our speeds, also as a list. Kinematic differential equations, that's relating our generalized coordinates and our generalized speeds. We created that back in notebook 3. They're equivalent to the derivative, so omega 1 minus theta 1 dot is 0. So this is just a set of equations that all are 0. So then we create our Kane's method class by passing all of those in. The inertial frame is just our inertial frame. It's the one that's attached to the foot. All right. So now after that, we need to express the last two things we created. We need the loads or our masses, or loads or our forces, I apologize, and then the bodies that we created. So loads, we have the lower leg graph, upper leg graph, and torso graph. So that's the force of gravity on all of our center of masses, and the torques at each of our joints. So that's also a list of expressions. Here's tools. And then our bodies. So the lower leg, upper leg, and torso. So Kane's method, Kane.Kane's equations, is the one that actually does all of the math. So that takes in our loads and our bodies and spits out FR and FR star, which are two matrices that sum to zero. So if you remember from physics, you have F equals MA, and T is equal to the inertial matrix times the angular acceleration. So Kane's method just composes that in a slightly different form. It all results to about the same physics anyway. So I'm going to run this. Not exactly? Yeah, it is exactly. And then run trigsimp. So that might be a mildly or severely complicated expression. One of our examples on our website is deriving the equations of motion for a bicycle, and that creates a really, really large expression that you need to simplify down if you're actually going to look at it, and even then it's really big. It's running for a bit. Actually, might be the printing time. Sometimes MathJax is slow. So while that's going, are there any questions so far? Cool. Yes.
Can I add something?
Yes.
I was just going to say, so the we have, you probably learned Newton-Euler's method, right, in class the first time. And you can use that here, too. Some people may be familiar with Lagrange's method or the Hamiltonian's method, right? There's a lot of ways to get to the final equations of motion. Gaines is just another one, and we have facilities to do other methods in there too, so ones that you're familiar with. And then the key thing about this is that it only needed those three special things, and that was we don't have to define the accelerations explicitly, if you notice that. We just define the velocities and pass velocity information in, and that's sort of the same with Lagrange's method too. So some of these methods let you do less work than you might have to in other ways. So, and this is just a demo of one of those.
Thanks. So this printed out. It's rather large. It's run onto two lines here, although there's nothing on the second line. But this is our equations of motion. They're not in the form. Is this still on? The form we're usually used to, though. So these sum to zero. So this whole expression right here is equal to zero. The common one people use. Might be used to is mass, so the mass matrix times x dot, which is the derivative of all of our states. So by states, I mean what are the positions, so theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3, and what are the velocities, so omega 1, omega 2, and omega 3. If you're going to be plotting, if you're going to be doing any simulation, those are the quantities you usually care about. And so x dot is a column vector of the derivative, x dot hat, x dot is the column vector of the derivatives of those. So you have the mass times that is equal to F, the forcing. And then to do actually a simulation to pass that into like ODE int from SciPy, or this is a Python thing, but if you use MATLAB, that'd be ODE 45 or something like that. It's basically an integration routine. You usually want to get that into a right-hand side form. So right-hand side, first order, ordinary differential equation. So that's a matrix. You can invert it, multiply it by F, and then you have a first order differential equation. So to do that, the Kane object, which is a Kane's method object we created above, has the mass matrix full and the forcing full attributes. And we can simplify those with trig simp to actually get the matrices, which we'll need for later. So I'll run both those. That one's still running. So you can invert that symbolically or solve it symbolically. Usually inverting a matrix and then multiplying it is not the way you'd want to do it. But for larger problems, that can be not effective. The expressions can be too big. So you might want to invert it numerically. And so you have a symbolic equation. You'll create the matrices that are actually numeric, and then you'll invert them at each time step. And Jason's going to talk about actually simulation here. So that is driving the equations of motion. So these can be used later on for simulation.
Okay, so like Jim said, this is the result, really, right? We've gone from describing some multibody dynamic system, and we have now the equations of motion of the system in potentially multiple forms that might be useful to whatever you're doing. And it's all symbolic. And I guess that's really the whole thing, right? So you can see this problem is what we would call a very simple problem, a baby toy problem. And that's how long the equations are if you were to write that out by hand. So you can imagine that the reason we have this software is so we can do non-toy problems and not have to write those things out by hand, right? But at this point, like Jim just mentioned, you mentioned numerics. At this point, we have an ODE, an ordinary differential equation. And if you remember from your ordinary differential equations class, only very simple ODEs are solvable by hand, right? If you want to find out the solution, and there's certain class of those problems that can, and in general, systems like this, you can't. It's a big, nasty, nonlinear equation, and there's no chance to solve that symbolically to find the trajectories of these of the states, right? How the positions and the velocities change with time. So we're going to integrate those these equations numerically. And the so we've mostly been in SymPy so far and used a lot of SymPy features. Now we're going to bring in NumPy, SciPy, and the other package that we have called PyDy. And PyDy really sort of consumes all the symbolics and generates vast numeric codes so we can sort of bridge this gap. And so now we're at this, it's this dividing line between symbolics and numerics. And so the next notebook is about how do we integrate those ODEs. Hopefully, how do we integrate them so they can be fast, so we can simulate them and do computation and analyses with them. So we'll start off at the top. It's notebook number 7. And we're going to import the results from the previous notebooks with the first line. And we're going to bring in some NumPy functions. So NumPy basically lets you do fast array calculations. So we're going to use that. We're going to use the ODE int, which I, described at the beginning. And that's a general purpose numeric routine for integrating ordinary differential equations. And then we're going to bring in this function called generate ODE function from PyDy. And this takes the symbolic stuff that we've got in our hands on now, and it's going to generate some, it basically does a sort of just-in-time compilation behind the scenes to build some fast numeric functions that evaluate the right-hand side of that first-order ODE. So we're going to bring that tool in. And it's possible that some of you may have not installed that. That doesn't come by default with Anaconda, so raise your hand if you get an import error there. And we'll still print some symbolics. We're going to use matplotlib to plot again, so we'll do inline plotting in the notebook. Bring in our various plotting functions that will be useful. And this is a quick thing to set the size of the plot, so it shows up reasonable size on the screen. Okay, so there's a lot of variables that are inside those symbolics, right? We defined a lot of constants, right? Like the acceleration due to gravity, the masses, the inertia terms, the lengths, and the distance. Those do not change with time. So all those are constant values. And here, I just make a list of those symbols. And so these are all the constants that are in those equations of motion. In fact, like SymPy has some facilities to get those out. So if I I think we have a forcing vector. I think this is the function that why did I fail? I've set. Oh, that's not a function. It's an attribute. So the forcing vector holds some of the symbolics of the equations of motion. You can see that basically matches what we got. We got all of the we have the mass matrix too. And I don't know why I'm not remembering my keyboard shortcuts. And the mass matrix. There's not. I did this just to be explicit above. You'd want to gather those, and then right there I would have to do a union on the two sets, right, to make a unique list. And then I have to pop T out because we don't consider T a constant. Okay. But that's just a general attribute of all SymPy objects that if you have an expression, it'll give you all the components of that expression, all the base components. And we have another function in mechanics that'll find all the pieces that are dependent on time. So like when I have big systems, I'll use functions like this just to pull them out automatically instead of typing them out individually. So you can do that. But we're going to use that, and we're going to put them in this specific order, and you'll see why we need that too. All right, so then we define these, I think we already defined these lists, but we define these lists of the coordinates and the speeds, and if you concatenate those, that is the states too, right? These change with time. These are the variables that change with time. There's also some other variables that change with time, and those are the joint torques, right? So these are the torques that are going to cause motion between the objects besides gravity. So for an exercise there, go ahead and create just a list of those. It's very, I guess that's a menial task. We'll see how fast everybody can do that. We'll think a better exercise in the next version. I'm going to go ahead and move forward on that one. So just make a list of the additional time-varying variables. So we have the states, which are made up of the coordinates and the speeds. And then we have what I call here specified inputs to the system. Right? These are things that eventually we're going to control. We don't know the input to those. And we're going to hopefully make a controller that will give the right torques that will make our system stand up eventually. Okay, so let's take a look at ODD int, right? So as I mentioned at the beginning, this runs a generic routine called LSOTA from the ODE pack. It's an older Fortran library, but it has a nice integrator that can handle stiff and non-stiff systems, and it'll automatically switch too. And you can even provide the Jacobian of the ODEs and things, and so it's a good general purpose integrator, and the whole function ODEINT is dedicated to that. If we look at the help of ODEINT, notice that what do we need to pass into it? So it has to have a function first that computes the derivatives of, in this case, y, right, at the value t, 0, in the description down here. So we want to create that function. We've got I'll write this up on the board to remind us. We've got the equations of motion. They're essentially F equals ma, and for our case, torque equals I alpha. But we have them in this form that's m x dot equals F, right? And this is a vector. This is a matrix. And that's a vector. I'll put a bar over that too. And x bar, right, is theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, omega 1, omega 2, omega 3. And what ODEINT wants, right, it wants the form of the equations x equals m inverse f. So we need a function that evaluates the derivative of the states. That's what ODEINT needs. And what we have right now are symbolic versions of M and F. That's the last thing that Jim showed you in the equations of motion slide. So we need to come up with this function here that evaluates that, the right-hand side. And that's the first argument to ODEINT. And then it needs initial conditions, right? So when you integrate if you remember from your ordinary differential equations, to integrate that, we have to give it some initial conditions, some state, some value of the state. We're going to use this value of the initial conditions such that the body's standing up straight, basically. And I'll talk about more of that in a minute. It needs t, time, and time's a vector or an array of time values that you want to integrate over. Okay? And then finally, we're going to use the optional argument args to pass in extra arguments, and you'll see why in just a minute. So the key thing is we got to generate that function. So that's where this generate ODE function comes into play. So notice what we pass into this. We're going to pass in the symbolic forcing vector, the symbolic coordinates, the symbolic speeds, the symbolic constants, which we defined above, the symbolic mass matrix, and the symbolic specified values. So we basically give this all of the symbolic information that that describes everything that's in M and F, the mass matrix and that forcing vector. Does that make sense? And what this does behind the scenes is it generates a function that will numerically evaluate the right-hand side of that ODE, and hopefully efficiently. Like Jim mentioned, inverting that is typically, you know, inverting big mass matrices is a bad idea numerically. It takes too much computation speed, but there's efficient ways to solve for X dot. Most basic being just simple Gaussian elimination. So there's some things that happen behind the scenes here to hopefully give you a reasonably efficient numerical function. And we can see that it returns this function, the right-hand side. And if I look at the help of the function, it tells me a lot. It says, I have a right-hand side, and it takes some arguments, required arguments. And then it has a signature right here, right? It takes x, which is the state vector, and that's an ND array for a NumPy, a NumPy array, shape 6. Has to be in this order. It tells you the order that the state is, state vector. Takes a time value, which is a float. Takes r, which are the values of the specifieds, and those in our case are the joint torques. It's a shape 3, and it can come in multiple forms. We're going to use the form number 2 here, an ND array with specified values in the correct order and the correct shape. So it's supposed to be shape 3. And they're in that order. The specified should be in that order. So it generates this function, and the doc string is sort of automatically generated from everything you pass in to give you an idea of what you need. Finally, the last argument, P, that's an array that holds the numerical values for all the constants in the system, the gravity, acceleration due to gravity, the masses, and everything. So we now have this function that we can evaluate numerically, and that takes all the symbolics and makes a nice fast function to evaluate the right-hand side. So I'm going to just say that the state initial condition, x0 here, is just 0, so we'll start with that. But then I'm going to change the I'm going to offset it by 2 degrees, right? So instead of standing straight up, I'm going to offset each of the angles by 2 degrees, so we're sort of standing at a non-stable. If you set it at perfectly vertical and you integrate forward, it's a stable situation. Nothing's going to happen, right? It's just going to stand there. But if we're off a little, some motion's going to happen because gravity is going to be pulling on all of the bodies. So we're going to set that to be offset a little, and it's got to be in radians. I've given you some default numerical values for a realistic human, right? What these inertia values should be, what the masses for all the body segments are and stuff. And that's the array that has the constants. So I've given you all those pieces. You got the numerical values now. You got this function. So now try to, first create, I'm getting ahead of myself, but you have the constants, which is an array of numerical values, and you have the numerical initial condition. We need some numerical values for the specified values, those 3 joint torques. So go ahead and create, just make those 0. We're going to say no, there's no, the person's not using their muscles, and they're not using any forces. So make an array of those for 0, and then also create an array for time, over 10 seconds, so we can simulate through an array, a time array, all right? And then reset your stickies and give me a yellow for got it, and a red for you need help, okay? I think we got the majority. So I was intending, my solution's wrong here. Okay, the numerical specified is correct. This, let me just delete this thing. This was old. Can you write that down to fix that later? So this is basically what the solution should look like. Numerical specified is just an array of three zeros. And then I use lint space here to create a time array from zero to the final time. And at 60 hertz here, 60 frames per second. So that's what I came up with. Oh, yeah, based on the thing. Let's do 10. All right, so thank you. All right, well, anyways, that's still the gist. Sorry for the wrong solution. But now we have a time array. I'll run it again. So at this point, we have all the pieces that allow us to evaluate that right-hand side function. So that it'll compute the derivatives of the states given some value of the states, some value of time, and the numerical values for the specifieds and the constants. If you look back at the help file for the right-hand side, right, it takes x, t, r, and p. And that's what, and then this next cell, gotta pass it, this next cell here, I just pass in the initial condition, x equals 0, and time equals 0, and then I give it those numerical values. And what it returns is an array, and that computes the derivatives of the states, giving this the formulation that we've derived. So now you can pass that function, the right-hand side function, now that we know it works, to ODEInt. I can give it the initial conditions, x0. I can give it our time vector, t. And then we're going to use that args, right? So the bare minimum right-hand side function just has x and t. But we have some two extra things. We have r and p, the specifieds and the constants. So we're going to pass those in as a tuple to the args argument of ODEInt. And what it'll do is it'll integrate those equations of motion given those initial conditions. And it returns a vector. In this case, I should have had that written as x, but it's called y now, and it's a 2D array, right? We had 6 states and 600 time points. So now we have an array such that we have the motion of the object given those initial conditions. Any questions about what all happened there? Nope. All right. So we'll use matplotlib now, and I'm going to plot the first three, and I'm going to use the radian to degrees so I can see it all in degrees. I use the VLATEX thing we imported. It prints, it's basically a specialized printer from the mechanics module to print SymPy objects, so we can print just the coordinate values for the legend. So is that what everybody sees? And they run that? Something similar? So what do you think? What do we see there? Any observations? None? This is what we expect? No. What did you expect? What does it mean? What happens when it goes to? It's going nuts, right?
Yeah.
Well, we don't have, like a human has, I can't bend my leg past a certain angle. We have joint stiffness and damping and all these things. So we didn't include that in the model, which we could. Our model is modeling things as a pure pin joint, no friction. So, yeah, we've got some crazy motion. Go ahead and plot the velocities and see. So the angular velocities, the last three, and see what those numbers look like. Right.
So how would you constrain angles?
Yeah, so there's multiple ways. Sometimes you can make kinematic constraints, which that means I can just say that angle is not going to go, can't go past this, and it stops. But you need some behavior. But that's not really what happens in a human. Really what happens in a human is we've got, like, mushy stuff between our joints, right? And what you would do is figure out, can you model that? Can I maybe use a spring? Sometimes you use spring and a damper model. It can sometimes take care of it, too. So when I push the leg so far, but the stiffness increases and it won't let me push. You know, I'd have to push extreme force to push it past its limit, right? So you could set up, that's how I would do it here, probably set up some kind of biologically mimicking damping and stiffness in the joints that would limit that. Oh, from, yeah, well, those are what are called kinematic constraints. So you basically write additional equations that enforce those laws about your kinematics, and that would say that if the angle got to here, if it goes past that, it would always be that angle, right? So you could just sort of say, if my joint limit is here, 90 degrees, say, if the system ever says it wants to go to 91, I just make it be 90, right? That's sort of defining a kinematic law that you can make up yourself. But robots, even though you typically do that for some systems, but the reality is all systems have flex. All systems can be pushed past their limits, so you have to decide whether you want to, how you want to model that. It's a modeling decision.
But you just have like theta max equals something, and then if the proposed angle greater than theta max,
that's one way to do it. Yeah, but it's probably not the right way. Yeah. So you can set up kinematic constraints that just, like, if you think about like we have all the links here, we can make a four-bar mechanism. If I attach the head to the ground with another pin joint, then I've got this parallelogram that moves. Attaching the head is another way of specifying a kinematic constraint. It says that point can only be in this location, and so then my motion can only happen in this way, only a certain amount of angles. And if you make the links wrong, you could have that lock up, and it would basically have a mathematical inconsistency, and you'd get some... So it's really kinematic constraints for some of that. Okay. Zero we defined up. So zero, he was basically standing up. You can do percent matplotlib nbag for notebook ag, I believe, or maybe even just notebook, and it would allow you to zoom in on those. Huh? Either would work. He's the main matplotlib developer, I believe, right? So thank you for that. If I just do that right now, will it automatically reset to work? So if I run notebook there instead, come back to my plot, I get a figure now that I can zoom in on, which is pretty cool. And we can see that it didn't quite start at zero, right? It started at two, right? Our initial conditions. We put all three of those angles at two degrees. Yeah, we should have been using that the whole time. That's much nicer. So notebook was what I added instead of inline. Okay, so either that or nbag, if you guys want to use those interactive plots.
Are they synonyms or are they different?
Okay, so did everybody get the last plot? Right, crazy velocities. So what we have is a chaotic system, actually. It's a... going nuts. And what we want to do in the next notebook is visualize that. So notebook number 8 is going to use some other tools from PyDai that let us sort of see what's going on. Like, the plots are useful, but with dynamic systems, you want to see things moving. You want to see animations. You want to see this stuff, so it help you understand. So what we have a package in PyDai And just to, I'm going to remind you, this we're going to make use of the colors here. We're not going to make like a really human-looking shape. You could. We're going to keep it simple. But we'll use the same color. So you remember blue is low, and green and red. We'll import the solutions from the last notebook. And PyDye has a package called Viz. And what it is, it's sort of a wrapper for WebGL visualizations that will allow us to look at motion of 3D objects in the browser here. And we have sort of the default shapes. We use this library called 3JS. These are the default shapes. So we're going to use some of these shapes to build something that mimics the look of our system. And to do that, we're going to use visualization frames and a scene class. The visualization frame, the whole purpose of that is to marry a shape to essentially a reference frame or a rigid body. Because a rigid body is like a very mathematical concept. It's some blob with inertia, but you might want to put associate different shapes with that. So we have these two concepts. We're going to have a shape, a reference frame, and then we hook them together with a visualization frame, and that's going to make sure that the shape fits on the rigid body in the right orientation and location. we're going to use spheres to model the joints. And if you take a look, like each of these classes for the shapes, they usually have some kind of parameter. In this case, a radius. And you can pass in SymPy values, symbolics, or numerics to these, and it'll all work out. So we're going to do a black sphere for each of the joints, the ankle, the knee, and the hip. And then I'll make a little bit bigger one. We'll add a head on the top of the body, too. All right? And we'll just give those numeric values. And here's the visualization frame. Which I think actually has a, I need to make a better doc string for it, but it can take one of three things: a reference frame and a point, a rigid body, which also has a reference frame and a point inside it, or a reference frame and a particle has a point. And we didn't talk about particles today, but that's also another object. So you can, what we're going to do is pass in, a reference frame and a point and the shape. To that. Okay, so these next three lines, I create a visualization frame that says, we're not worried about it doesn't matter if you rotate the sphere, it always looks the same. So I just chose to use the inertial reference frame for the sphere. So if I have a sphere and it's attached to the inertial reference frame and attached to a point defined in the inertial reference frame, that sphere is going to move around with the point, but it's not going to rotate. Okay, and it doesn't matter if it rotates because it always looks the same anyways, unless maybe, I guess if you put we do have textures, you could put a texture in there and then maybe you'd want it to rotate. But anyways, for each of the joints, we marry a reference frame and a point to a shape. Any questions on that? We don't have a point for the head. It wasn't an important point, right? This is the other thing, like a rigid body only has a mass center, but we need a new point for the head. So I'll make a new point here and make it just two times we had a center mass of the torso, and I just doubled it. It'll put a point up a little higher, right, a shape up there. So we create a new point, set its position, same way we did in the earlier notebook with Jim, and create that reference frame. Okay, so we also need to create some new points. We have the mass center location. That isn't equidistance between the joints. And the shape cylinder, though, the center of the cylinder shape is always at its geometric center. So we want a point that we can align the shape's geometric center to the point that's equidistance between the joint of the body. So you can see why it's a little messy, because all the mathematical formulations to get the equations of motion don't rely on like a lot of the points that we think about in real space, in real life. So we've got to create some extra points. In this case, I have the center of the joints, the geometric center of the joints. Those are extra points, and they're just half the length of the joints. I'm going to create a dictionary here that maps all of our symbols for the constants to the numerical values that we created before. We're going to pass that in two. And then we're going to use cylinders, like I just mentioned, to describe between the joints. Really, we're going to have a big cylinder that's both legs, one cylinder here, one cylinder for the torso. A cylinder has a radius, which will give a numerical value. But I want to make sure that the length matches the correct numerical value here. So I just pulled out that, I used my dictionary that I created and this in the SymPy symbol to get that numerical value. And then it will make those blue, green, and red to match the bodies, right? The three cylinders. And that, and then I create the reference, the visualization frame for those. So now we have four points, four spheres, and four and three cylinders that represent the three bodies we had in our system. And now we create a scene, and the scene consumes all those visualization frames, and it's going to compute everything it needs to know to make these shapes move on the screen properly. And a scene, you can take a look at that. It takes a base reference frame. So we're going to use our inertial frame, and that's like the camera, wherever the fixed camera frame is. You could put the camera on the leg, and it would move with the leg, or you could put the camera on a fixed frame. And we're going to use that fixed frame as the thing. And it also is going to locate the camera relative to the to some point. Yes? Yes. That otherwise, my cylinder, so I defined a center point of the torso, right. Geometric center, and then a point up here for the head. Right. And then I want my cylinder to be twice the torso center mass length. So I put the center of the torso at the same spot as the center of mass above. Okay, they got it. So to start, I'll create the scene. I'm going to give it the ankle point as the base point in the scene and the inertial reference frame. And that's, we couldn't get our cameras working properly, so that's that warning for the latest release. You can ignore that for now, but it's not going to have any bearing here. And then we're going to pass in a list here of all those visualization frames we created. And then finally, we're going to tell it some information. The symbolic states, that dictionary of constant values that map the symbols of the constants to the numerics. And then y was our state trajectory, right? How the states changed through time. And we can pass those in. And so then the final piece here, and I'm going to maximize the screen a little, is that we can display that scene. And so hopefully you see this same thing. We have the cylinders that map to each of the bodies and spheres that map to the joints and then one sphere for the head. And I can play that. And we see that, this is the motion that those plots were getting, right? So we don't have any like biomechanical constraints there. And so we basically just have a three-link inverted pendulum with these certain inertia and mass definitions, and it falls. We have no control, and it's a dynamic system. And you can, you know, wiggle this thing around, pan, and zoom with your, I don't know, on the trackpad, you maybe do two fingers or something, if that's what you have, and you can loop it if you want. And there's other things here, too, like you can... We didn't give names to any of the objects, but you could have named them when you defined them, and then you can edit their colors and other things like that and stuff. But anyways, this is this basic visualization. Okay. So the exercise here is to try to put a nose on the head of the sphere, pointing in the right direction. There is a, we'll probably skip this one, but we'll work on that one. And there's a shape. You can use whatever shape you want, but you're probably going to have to do some orientations to get it right, because the default axes of the shapes don't necessarily match the axes of your object. So you might have to rotate a reference frame to make sure the nose points in the right way, and then attach the nose to that reference frame. So that's the example. That's the exercise. And this one we'll spend a little time on. It's the longer example of our thing. And we've got an hour and 12 minutes, so we're doing good. So you guys spend some time on that. And yes. No, it you can. There's a scene.display, and it'll open it up in a web browser, a separate window. Also, is that? It's a web tool. It's based on WebGL. Yeah, it's not. Maybe I guess you can embed it in an app too, so, or like a native app. I don't know, but yeah, it's just JavaScript. Does everybody get the premise of that? Try to get a nose of some sort on the head of the object, and put your yellow sticky up when you got that, and we'll. Last time I gave this, we tried to have the person come up and show their nose, so we'll try to do that again. But twitching the computer was may or may not work. So Lucas, he's our first.
Old where's your winner?
Yeah.
On this side.
There you go. He's got our first successful nose, and he's going to demonstrate, and he's going to tell you.
VGA-compatible successful.
How he did it. Oh, he's the first VGA-compatible nose. Technically, what was your name?
Justin.
Justin? He technically Justin got it.
All right. So here is the finished product. So to get there, what we did was, first we had to import this like shapes module. You guys probably figured out to get the cone shape. I just defined a point nose, and then I copied the same position vector we used for the head and just added an X component to the torso frame, so it's in the same position, just kind of moved outward a little bit from the torso, which if some of you guys maybe got there, it gives you a nose, but it's like straight up and down. It's kind of like off your face and pointing downward. So then what you have to do is give the nose its own reference frame, because the only way to do rotation with the system is to rotate an entire frame. You can't rotate a specific object within a frame. So here we create a separate reference frame for the nose and orient it relative to the torso frame. So here I said relative to the torso frame, 1.7, you know, roughly pi half radians along the z-axis. So z coming out of the board, and that's the way you want to rotate it, is you want to rotate it from being like this to being like that. So you're rotating it, you know, 90 degrees relative to the z-axis. And then just create the visualization frame out of the your new frame point and shape, tack it onto the list of visualization frames, and there you go.
All right, let's give Lucas a hand. Nice. Yep, that's a great solution. Okay, well, we're going to move on. We've got one last notebook. And Jim is going to teach you all how to get this person to stand up instead of fall down. You guys want a break?
We have time for a break.
Take a five.
They did.
Oh, they took away the cookies?
Drinks.
Okay.
Still drinks, but no cookies.
So nobody needs to go to the bathroom or anything? We're good? All right. Okay.
Oh, awesome. Cool. All right. So last notebook. So we've already covered basics of, you know, somewhere between undergrad and grad school dynamics course. in like 3 hours. So now we're going to cover an undergrad controls course in 15 minutes. So, briefly. So, if you remember our previous visualization, guy kind of danced around. He flailed around like one of those things that advertise for cars, the blowy dolls. Yeah. So, we want to make sure he's standing up. You know, you don't fall down while you're standing, and that's because the body has an internal control system. You're somehow able to get the feedback from your, you know, you're touching the ground, so you get that force feedback. You have a vestibular system, that's your balance, and then feedback from your eyes to know if you're standing upright. And so all of those feedbacks allow you to stay, you know, vertical by giving commands to your muscles to, you know, hold you in that position. So we're going to develop a controller, that's what you'd call it, that kind of feedback thing that keeps the guy standing upright. So, and then we'll run the simulation again and we'll see him hopefully not fall down. So, start out with importing a pile of things, like always. This is going to rely on it's going to rely on a pile of NumPy things. So we need an array, zeros, I, a couple other things in there. Create the plotting, get that all set up. SymPy printing. And we'll change the precision. This just makes it so when we print out numbers, we don't get 14 decimal places. We only care about the first three. Cool. So what do we still have on the board? All right, so where we last left off, we had this equation. We had a big M, it's our mass matrix, x dot, it's all of our states, that's the position and velocities, is equal to F. So this is a nonlinear system. F is nonlinear. By linear, we mean, does everyone know what linear means? Do I need to explain that? Briefly, if we don't, linear systems are things like ax plus b. Nonlinear could have sine, cosine, all sorts of, you know, weird things that don't plot a straight line or a straight plane or in, you know, higher dimensions. So it's a nonlinear system. Linear control is, I don't want to say solved, but the math is very, very, very well done. You can create controllers for linear systems fairly easy. Your nonlinear controllers, there's all sorts of ways to do them. But the easiest way to do a nonlinear controller is just to linearize your system. So we're going to take this equation, which we actually rewrote earlier, x dot is equal to m inverse f. And that is an equation we're going to rewrite. It's approximately, so a little wiggly equals sign. It's approximately equal to A x plus B u. Or R, I'm trying to remember what notation we used. What did we say in the notebook? Were you doing U or R? We're doing U. Okay. So this is linearizing about some set point. So when we say linearizing about a set point, that is some position that we'd like to maintain. And that should be an equilibrium point, so it should be stable. So when you're standing upright, you're stable. The other equilibrium point for a pendulum, if it was a single pendulum, could be straight down. So you can imagine if we had a pendulum here, here's the pivot point. If it's perfectly set upright, it's going to bounce, right? But as soon as you tip it, just a little bit tips over. And then you have the other one, which is pointing straight down. So we care about this one. We want the guy to be standing straight up. So that's all of our coordinates at zero, standing completely vertical. So we're going to linearize about that set point. And so instead of having a continuous thing, we're going to have, it's going to be perturbations. So it's delta x dot. Small change in x, small change in u, about that set point. So it's only going to be holding true for approximately vertical, so slightly off one way, slightly off the other way, our nonlinear equations will be approximated by our linearized version. If you get too far off, then they don't make sense anymore, they don't match up. So the way to do this for our system is just to take the Jacobian, which is a matrix of partial derivatives. So, we described it in this form. So I wrote it like this. We are working on it like this. So we still have M on this side. And instead of A and B, we have F sub A and F sub B. And later on, we can just invert M and put M inverse F of A, or F sub A, and M inverse F sub B, and get the same form I wrote up earlier. So those are just equal to the partial of F over, for X1, all the way through Xn. And remember, X is our states, so theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, omega 1, omega 2, omega 3. And then for B, it's respect to U, which is our control inputs, and in this case, it's the torques, so all of our joint torques. You can do this manually in SymPy. SymPy has a Jacobian function, but we provide a function in Pi or in the mechanics module that does all of this for you quickly. So first we need to create our equilibrium point. As I said before, that is standing completely vertical, so all of our coordinates are at zero. So we're going to create zeros of length coordinates plus speed. So it's going to be a six long vector. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then equilibrium dict is just a mapping of our symbols to our equilibrium point. So it's just going to be mapping theta 1 to 0, theta 2 to 0, so on and so forth. Cool. So for an exercise, we need to create a parameter dict that maps the symbolic constants. So those are all of our constants from before to the numerical values. It looks like we didn't leave a blank for that in here. So you have to create a new line above that in the notebook. So I'll quickly load the solution there. So here we have our constants in this list and then our numerical constants from before. So we're just mapping that dict zip, which creates an iterable that returns two values, one from this, one from that each time. And then that's going into the dict, which creates a dictionary. So that is our dictionary mapping constants to values. So as I mentioned before, you can do this all in SymPy yourself. We have a linearizer object, which does this automatically. For simple systems, so things that don't have constraints, just doing the Jacobian, it works. But if you have an overdefined system, then you have to be a little careful, which is why we have our linearizer object. You don't need to worry about that right now, though. So just create a linearizer with the toLinearizer method. And that little cell here. Oh, what did that do? All right, linearizer. So, a little doc string on this. It holds the general model form. We don't really care about that. What we care about is, and it's not in there. It's not in our doc string. The linearizer dot linearize method. So this is actually what performs the computation. So we'll be using this later. Before that, though, we need to start rearranging a couple things. So if you remember, we had the specifieds before. That was our input vector. That was our U in what I wrote up there. There's a couple different symbols that are commonly used. That's in a specific order from our old equation. Unfortunately, how the linearizer works is it's sorted alphabetically, not by what we mandated earlier. So if I run this, this is going to return false. They're not equivalent. So we have to rearrange that. I mean, that's easy enough. Just linearizer.r, which is our input vector, is equal to the matrix that we want. So just change it. We might change that interface in the future. Opening this back up, help on the linearize method. So this takes in an operating point, which is the vector I was talking about before, the one that says everything is zero. We want it to be standing vertically, not tipping over. A and B tells if we want to return the A and B matrices that I wrote up earlier or not. The default is not to. And then simplify, if we want it to automatically simplify it down, get a little simpler form for the equations or not. So we are going to create A and B. So A and B is equal to linearizer.linearize. Our operating point is everything we want to linearize about plus all of our constants. So it's just an iterable, so a list here, of our equilibrium point, which is the one that says everything is vertical, so all zeros, and then our parameter dict, which is the one that maps all of our constants to actual values. You don't need to pass the parameters in at this point, but because we're performing some mildly complex calculations, the fewer symbolic things you have in there, the more numerical, it'll run slightly faster. And then A and B equals true, just so we get A and B rather than different form. So I'll run that. We get an A and a B matrix. This might, do I want to do this? This might be really long. No, it's numeric. We're good. We're good. It's all fine. So that's A. I can run B. If it was symbolic, that might have been a large expression. So that's what our matrices look like. That is forming. If I write that up here. Forming that equation there, where A and B are the matrices we just got, delta X is the deviation from vertical, so it's no longer our actual state value, it's just deviation. So if it's perfectly standing, delta X is zero. And then delta U is the change in control values from what we said before. So scroll down, we're going to convert those into NumPy arrays, so A and B. Are now NumPy. So there's A and there's B. Okay, so on to controller design. So we have expressed our system now as a linear system, and so the maths for actually deriving a controller are a lot simpler. The first thing we need to do though is check if it's controllable. So what controllable means is if given our inputs, so the inputs to our system, the torques at each joint, can we actually make this guy stand up? For a simpler and non-mechanical system, you could imagine something electrical where we have an input like a switch and you want to say, can I actually turn the light on? Well, you can only actually turn the light on if it's even connected to it. You might have a switch that works on your oven and you're saying, I can turn my kitchen light on by turning the switch. It's not controllable because the systems aren't connected. And then there's other things that can be mathematically related to that. So controllable is just seeing if it's even worth designing a controller. Can we actually have a controller for this system that will stabilize it? So that returns true. Our system is controllable. And so now we're going to use something from optimal control. So it's expressing the control problem as a minimization, or as an optimization problem. Actually, I suppose that's on the slide. I don't need to draw that up. We're going to be using this minimization function here. So what that is minimizing is saying over the total integral of time, xt, so x is our state, so transpose x, times some matrix q times x, plus ut r u over the whole integral of time, we want to minimize that. So if you think about it, Q and R are weights. Those aren't given, those are specified. We can play around with those parameters to give a different controller. Q is a weighting on our error. As I said before, X is not our total state anymore. X is deviation from vertical. So if X is zero ideally, right? We want him to be standing. So if X isn't zero, then there's some error. He's not standing up perfectly. So if you make Q bigger, you're weighting the error more. R is a weighting on U, so if we make R bigger, we're weighting what we'd call our controller effort. So you're saying how much effort do we want to be putting into this? How much energy will the person be using to stand up? So this is a solved problem. This can be optimized exactly by solving a Riccati equation, which SciPy provides a nice function for. So we can import that. So SciPy, solve continuous ARE. Takes in A, B, Q, and R. So if we look up here, we got an A matrix, a B matrix, Q matrix, and an R matrix, and it returns S. And the optimal controller, which we want to actually get, is K up here, and K is equal to R inverse B transpose S. So we need to actually specify what our weights are. For simplicity, we'll just say they're both identity matrices. So I6 and I3. And now we can actually get K by solving the continuous algebraic Riccati equation. So that is our controller matrix. So the controller, if we go back up here, do we write that? Yeah, so the controller is how we get this input. So remember, our inputs are our three torques, torque at the ankle, torque at the knee, and torque at the hip. And so what we want is some mapping from X, which is our state at that time, times K minus is equal to what input you should be giving at that time. And so going down, we need to pass in something to the right-hand side function that we generated before to actually create that control function. So if we look at the right-hand side docstring again, it takes in a couple optional things for R. So it takes in either a dictionary, an ND array, or a function. So if we scroll down to where it talks about the function must be of the form g of x, comma t, where x is the current state vector. So that was, I erased that. That was all of our coordinates and all of our speeds, and then the time. And then it returns what the input matrix should be. So that should be a 3x1 matrix that we're returning, which is our control inputs. So you need to create a function up here. Where was that? It's down. Create a controller function that takes in the state and the time and then returns what the control input should be. So you can do that exercise real quick.
We write the control log.
Oh, yeah, I'll do that. Function we're looking for here is taking in x and t, that's the mandated function signature, and then just turning minus dot, which is how NumPy does matrix multiplication, k and x. So we're just forming that expression here. So I'll create that function. And now we can actually integrate the equations of motion again, but we're going to use the controller instead of the passed in r. So another exercise here, actually run the simulation. So earlier you ran one in a previous notebook where you passed in constant matrix for R. This time you're going to pass in this function instead. And then when you're ready, put the sticky backup on. So real quick, cruise through the remaining cells. So I'm going to load the solution here. It's almost exactly what we had before, but instead of passing in a vector for what we're doing for the inputs, we're passing in our controller. So we run the simulation, create plots of the trajectories. That was the next exercise. Did anyone not go through that immediately?
Solve the result. What did people find?
Did it stabilize? It stayed upright? Yeah, so if I'll run that real quick so we can talk about it. Yeah, so you can see they all go to zero. And so remember, zero for the deviation was actually vertical. So we're all good on that. We can plot the velocities as well. And those also converge. So it's staying vertical, or it goes to vertical, and then it's staying. It's not moving anymore. Display it. So it goes upright from slightly off. So a couple of people asked, I'll just say this to everyone to hear it, how you could make it have a more active visualization. So if I run that again, you can see it just starts slightly off vertical and then goes to completely vertical. So that has to do with the initial condition. So we linearized off being vertical. So if you get too far, the linearization will no longer hold and the controller won't be able to stabilize. But if you can increase slightly from off vertical, we should be able to get a larger motion. So everyone can try that, or I'm going to quickly go through it up here too. So X naught, if I run that, you can see what X naught is. That is our original initial condition. So we have a small deviation from standing vertically, and then we have a small amount of velocity. So it's slightly moving already. If I increase that, so we'll subtract another term and say minus, I don't know, 0.02. This may or may not stabilize. I'm not sure. I should rewrite that as X. Or just do it down here. Minus 0.02. So slightly farther off of standing vertically. Rerun the simulation. Let's plot it. Okay, so that still remains stable. This stabilized down here in under 2 seconds. That's still under two. I'm gonna increase that a little more. Let's go off by 0.6. All right. So that's still stabilizing. We can run that. I gotta run it again. Yeah, you're right. So there he starts a little farther off and then eventually stands up. So that's one thing you can play around. Another thing you can do is change the controller weights. So the Q and the R that we talked about earlier, you can change those, you know, weight it more so it tries to be more efficient, you know, less energy used to control it, or you can weight it so that it cares more or less about, you know, its error. Those are a couple things you can play around with. So that concludes our tutorial. Questions, comments?
So thank you all for hanging out to 5. Give yourself a hand.